Hello students, a very very good evening to all of you. Welcome to my channel. This is a very important class on It's Easy to Learn Theory series, and today we will talk about a very recent theory, that is post-humanism. A few months ago, some of you have requested me to make a separate video on post-humanism. Of course, it is a very recently discovered theory, and still researches are going on this particular topic. I have gathered some information related to post-humanism, and I want to share this with you today so that you can develop a basic idea of what is this new theory all about. But before starting, I want to give you a brief introduction about myself. My name is Rishi Mukherjee. I have qualified NDUGC NEET exam in English Literature 4 times and have also qualified with West Bengal State examination. I have 3 years of teaching experience. Moreover, I have also taught the NPTEL online course from IIT Madras today. So that is all about myself. This is a link of my Telegram channel. The link is also given in the description box. So those of you who have not joined yet, please join to get notification of all important classes. And also please don't forget to like, share and subscribe my YouTube channel so that many more new learners can join. Okay. So let's start discussing post-humanism. Now, first of all, there is a question of what does the term post-humanism mean? Generally, the word post means after. We are all familiar with the term post. We have read post-colonialism, post-structuralism. So post means something that is beyond or after. So if we take an etymological meaning of the word, then post-humanism means something that is after humanism, after human or beyond human. So post-humanism is a very recent idea in continental philosophy. And it is a kind of response to the presence of anthropocentrism in 20th century. Anthropocentrism in 20th century. And to be very specific about what is meant by being a human in the 21st century, that is basically the idea of post-humanism. Now, first question comes that who coined the term post-humanism? So it has a very wide range of theorists, but if we talk about specifically the coinage of the term and in the sense which we are using it in today's world, it is done by Ehab Hassan. You have all heard his name. He is a very prominent theorist. Ehab Hassan coined the term in his work Prometheus as Performer towards a post-humanist culture. Prometheus as Performer towards a post-humanist culture, 1977. So during that time, Ehab Hassan coined the term. Now, what does it mean? The very first question arises that what does post-humanism mean? It's a very controversial term. And you can also say that it is an umbrella term to discuss. Many theorists raise the question that is post-humanism means the end of humanism or the end of the world or something beyond humanism? It is a matter of controversy. Because if we talk about post-humanism as an end of humanism, then it will raise a serious question against human existence in this world. And if we talk about post-humanism as the end of the world, then there is no need to specify any theories. If there is the end of the world, then no theory is needed. So this is the very first question, that what does post-humanism mean? Is it talking about the end of humanism or the aftermath of humanism? What is humanism? We all are familiar with the idea of Renaissance humanism. I have also explained it to you when we talked about Marlowe, when we talked about Dr. Foster's. And till now, Dr. Foster's is considered as a very prominent example of Renaissance man, Renaissance humanism. So if we go back to the age of Enlightenment and age of Renaissance, then you can remember that Renaissance humanism focuses on the utmost potentiality of human beings. And it believes that man is at the center of everything, anthropocentrism. The idea was very popular and it was taught by the Renaissance humanist that human beings are at the center of everything. They have utmost potentialities and they can do anything. Nothing is impossible for a human. But the idea of post-humanism is a kind of challenge or a kind of resistance towards this idea of Renaissance humanism. Post-humanism talks about the fact that no, man is not the ultimate. There are some things beyond mankind, beyond human civilization or beyond human, Homo sapiens as an existence. And it clearly challenges the ideas or the philosophies of Renaissance man as we have read about Faustus and other such knowledgeable characters. So, it challenges the ideas of Renaissance humanism. Now, if we talk about post-humanism in terms of literary theory, then the idea of post-human and the other ideas associated with it, it is discussed by M. Catherine Hales in a work called How We Became Post-Human. It is the name of the work, How We Became Post-Human. Catherine Hales talked about that. And this book mentions that post-humanism encompasses various styles. As I have already told you, it is an umbrella term. So it encompasses so many ideas. Specifically the ideas of human and with technology. Human and technology, as well as the idea of evolution. We have already read about Darwin's evolution theories, Origin of Species. So it is also a kind of evolution of human, but not from the Darwinian perspective, from the perspective of something beyond human. So we are considered the human being, the generation of Homo sapiens. It is considered as the best animal of the world till now, in terms of intellect, in terms of performance, in terms of strength. We are still the all-powerful species of the world. Post-humanism challenges this. Post-humanism is trying to find out a breakthrough against this all-rounder idea of human. And it also challenges the idea of being a human, a perfectionist, in terms of technology. Because technology has proved that human beings can be modified. There are something more which cannot be achieved alone by human without the help of technology. Post-humanism mainly talks about that. Now, if we take the history of the idea of post-humanism, then you will see that the idea is not new. Something beyond human or something that is not so specific about mankind, it is not new. If we look at the earlier novels or the endeavors of literature, for example, Frankenstein, we are all familiar with the text. So Frankenstein was written or was published in 1818, much before the idea of post-humanism. But if we look at the creation, the theme of creation or one type of cloning of the monster, then it clearly had some post-humanist undertone. Because the way Victor created a new species using all such animal body parts, stitching it together and giving life to it, it is clearly post-human. Now the monster cannot be specified as human and it also cannot be specified as animal. So there is a kind of in-between existence. That is why the monster also asks the question to Victor that who am I and why have you made me? Did I request the maker to make me? So this kind of crisis which the monster faced, he is clearly rejected by the human society. Even his creator Vittal is also repulsed by his appearance. So all these things are part of post-humanism. If we look at it, although at that time the term post-humanism was not coined, but the ideas of creation, ideas of cloning, creating a new life using animal body parts, these are all part of post-humanism. Take another example of Kazuo Ishiguro's novel, Never Let Me Go. Never Let Me Go. It is not a proper science fiction in the sense, but we can call it as a science fiction without any scientific element, which means that it talks about cloning, which are very familiar in today's medical world. The idea of cloning was there, but it was not specified as cloning. Ishiguro elaborated it. If we go back to the world of movies, then we can see that there are so many movies which talk about this artificial intelligence and robotics and the use of machines. You can take Hollywood movies, you can take Bollywood movies, take the very famous Bollywood movie, Robot. So in each and every movie where there is a clash between human and machine, it has been proved that machines can be dangerous because machines do not have brain. Take example of the movie Robot, 2010 movie by Rajinikanth. So it has proved that the creation of Dr. Vashikaran has a flaw. It is a machine, it is a robot, Chitti is a robot, but Chitti can be dangerous. And as he has no brain, as he has no emotions, so he can easily be exploited by other scientists. And by inserting a red chip into his body, he can perform destructive forces. And that is why the order was given by the court to dismantle it. So machines can be dangerous, and whenever machines are there, they are performing something dangerous, something destructive, then humans are there to rescue. So all the movies and the novels, each and everyone is trying to portray that human and technology, they are closely attached with each other. But when technology goes beyond control, then only humans can rescue the world. So ultimately the power of human is established. Post-humanism mentions, actually post-humanism blurs this boundary between human and technology. Post-humanism talks about the fact that as we are living in today's world, in today's 21st century, the modern era or the post-modern era, in today's world, machine and man, these two things are so attached or interrelated with each other that it is symbiotically moving to a new form of life. Not only the life of simple human or simple man, but it is moving to a new form of life. And that life is not only of pure human, but it is a combination of human and technology, of human and machines. And as I have already mentioned, that post-humanism questions the fact that who are we? We means the idea of human. Is it same as it was earlier during Renaissance humanism or before the arrival of this scientific technological field? Is it same right now? No. Post-humanism is expanding the boundaries of being human. And it raises questions of existence of mankind in this world and how is it relevant? Can man survive without the help of technology? Or is there any purposeful existence of mankind without technology, without the ideas of robotics, cybernetics? Is it possible? Post-humanism questions. Now, if we talk about the term post-humanism, then it has different types. Philosophical post-humanism, critical post-humanism, transhumanist post-humanism. There are so many things which are very new fields. The researchers are going on these particular fields. So critical post-humanism, the idea was actually explored by Octavia Butler. is a female science fiction writer, Octavia E. Butler. So her science fiction talks about this idea of critical posthumanism, and her notion of posthumanism is clearly bounded with the idea of posthuman bodies. He talks about posthuman bodies. Now, what do you mean by posthuman bodies? Butler mentions that there is a symbiotic relationship between human and non-human. So when there is a specific definition of what we call as human, there should also be a specific definition of what is non-human or someone who cannot qualify the status of human. And in the term of non-human, we can include aliens, we can include robots, we can include some other AI assistants, cyborgs. So Butler talks about all these things, the post-human bodies. And he also mentions a very interesting thing, that the earlier vampire stories, we are all familiar with the Gothic stories, which were very popular during the 18th century. Frankenstein is also a part of that Gothic horror franchise. Butler talks about the fact that if we closely look at the Gothic stories, particularly the vampire stories, which was made popular by Bram Stoker and other writers, the concept of vampire, it is very interesting. As we are talking about the progression of mankind, in terms of robot, in terms of AI assistance, there is also a regression of mankind in terms of vampire. And she very particularly gives example of Bram Stoker's Dracula. If you are familiar with the text of the novel, then you will find that the novel, Bram Stoker's Dracula, the title indicates that it is talking about a vampire, but if you start reading the novel, it is written in the form of a diary or a journal. So it mentions that Dracula is not a vampire, rather Count Dracula is a man. He is a very celebrated businessman of Transylvania. Jonathan Harker, another important character of this novel, or he is the narrator, he goes to meet with Dracula, Count Dracula, in some kind of business purpose in Transylvania, and there he encounters a lot of strange things. And he writes in his journal that Count Dracula is a very knowledgeable man. In his home, there are so many books, and Dracula is a very much an avid reader, you can say, who loves to discuss on books, on philosophies of life, and he can sit and talk endlessly about literature, about science, about geography, maps. He is such a knowledgeable person, but at night, that man gets transformed into a vampire. And Jonathan Harker very beautifully writes that, "I have noticed through my window that Dracula, as a man, at night he becomes a vampire. His two hands are getting transformed into two wings, and he just flies away." Now, what does that mean? Dracula is described as a man at the same time a vampire. So it is a kind of regression of mankind, that humans are in the process of returning to a more primordial state. This is also a kind of post-human reading of Dracula. If you want to read it from a post-human perspective, then you can identify these things, that Dracula is not properly a man, and not properly a vampire. He is a kind of in-between thing. At daytime, he is a man. At night, he gets transformed into a vampire. And Jonathan Harker also notices that he has connections with so many devils of the underworld. There are witches. There are some other vampires who are trying to drink Jonathan's blood. And Dracula encourages that this night, he is for you. You can enjoy him. The witches are there to drink the blood of Jonathan Harker. So all these kind of surroundings are there to describe the image of Dracula. He is not an animal. He's not a human. But at one point, he's a human, very talented human. And at one point of time, he transforms into a vampire. Bloodthirsty, very meager, primordial animal. So it is talking about that. But it also identifies that all the vampire stories, not only this novel, Dracula, but all the other vampire stories, they are part of post-humanism. So post-humanism is not only about the advancement of mankind, but it also talks about the regression of mankind. Advancement in terms of robots, in terms of AI assistants, and regression in terms of vampire, in terms of Dracula, in terms of some other primordial objects like the monster in Frankenstein, the aliens, all these ideas are there. Now, after reading so many books, I have identified some key terms which are very much related to post-humanism. I will talk about that one by one. So, the first important term is transhumanism. Of course, these terms are very confusing. Post-humanism, transhumanism, abhuman, non-human. But all of them are correlated with each other and at a single purpose, they are correlated under the umbrella term called posthumanism. Now, it is also a matter of debate that how should we write posthumanism? Posthumanism together or with hyphen? As there is also a debate regarding postcolonialism. Post hyphen colonialism has a different meaning, and postcolonialism talks about the colonial hangover, which are still there in the people of India or other colonized countries. Whatever. Coming back to transhumanism. So transhumanism means, trans means something that is transgressed, right? So transhumanism talks about the enhancement of human condition by developing the technology. And it is a term, it was popularized by Julian Huxley. Basic information. Popularized by Julian Huxley, and the first academic journal related to posthumanism, that is the Journal of Post-Human Studies, published by James Hume. In this particular journal, there is an extensive discussion on transhumanism. So transhumanism is described by the post-humanist critics in a positive sense. And it mentions the very idea of Renaissance humanism, or it negates the idea of Renaissance humanism, that humans are all powerful. Transhumanism talks about the fact that no humans have limitations. They are not something Superman or anything else. They have limitations, and if we want to overcome these limitations, then we need to have assistance of something, and that assistance will be the technology. So it talks about that with the advancement of technology, human cognition and bodily functions can be expanded. We can achieve something more. So, we can create robots, we can create cyborgs. These are all part of transhumanism, something that is crossing the boundary of human or being a human. And it puts a question mark on the absolute potentiality of human in this world. Again, there is a debate, there is a controversy raised by the feminist critics that posthumanism talks about only man and not for women. Again, when we go back to the idea of Renaissance humanism, it talks about man. So human is a general neutral term, but the feminist critics are trying to say that it talks about a man who is all powerful, but there is no mention of any women who is more powerful than man. Okay, so that is another matter of debate. I am not going into the depth of it. But if we take human as general term, man as general term, gender neutral term, then this idea of man as all powerful, it is questioned by transhumanist philosophers. And it mentions that man is not all powerful, but when man is added with technology, then it becomes supremely powerful. For example, when we create robots, so robots are given extreme power, supreme power, and robots can do those things which cannot be done manually by a man or by a human. So transhumanism talks about that, even the change of bodily functions also. That is also part of transhumanism. Okay. Now, the next term, two terms are there, anti-humanism and meta-humanism. Now, the word anti is always used in terms of negativity, right? So, anti-humanism, if we take the term, the etymological meaning of the term, then it means something that negates the idea of humanism. So, yes, it is true. It is against human potentialities. And it takes human potentialities in a negative sense. Whereas Renaissance humanism mentioned that humans can do better, or rather humans can do the best. There is nothing superior than human, or there is no one who is superior to human. Anti-humanism negates the idea. Anti-humanism says that no. It is true that human beings have a lot of potentialities, but this is also true that people can make good choices and satisfy their spiritual need without religion. It opposes the idea that human beings can also be destructive. As well as they can become constructive, they can as well as become destructive. And without the help of religion, they can do anything. Anti-humanism protests this idea. And anti-humanism also mentions that humanistic conception of life can be morally dangerous. This is the thing. If human beings are creating robots or machines, then they can also use it as destructive force. They can also use it as constructive force. So it can be morally dangerous also. The potentiality is both in the positive sense and in the negative sense. That is anti-humanism. And if we talk about meta-humanism, meta, you know, meta means beyond, as we have read metaphysical poetries. So meta-humanism, it talks about the criticism of some humanism's foundational philosophies, such as free will, autonomy, and superiority of anthropoid due to their rationality. So it focuses on a kind of critique of some ideas of humanism, like autonomy, like free will. We are all familiar with the terms. These are all the terms of the age of enlightenment. So, meta-humanists, they are protesting against that, and they are focusing on rationality. How far rationality is responsible to create a machine or to create a human? Meta-humanism talks about that. Then comes the term cyborg. Cyborg is a very popular term, you know, even in the field of cultural studies also, we have studied cyborg. So, and one name is clearly associated with cyborg, that is Donna Haraway, was cyborg manifesto. So, Donna Haraway mentions that who is cyborg? Actually, the word cyborg is a combination of two terms, cybernetic and organism. Cybernetic and organism. So, cyborg refers to a particular species in a post-gender world with no origin story in the Western humanists, which means that cyborg has no origin. And cyborg is a gender-neutral thing. We cannot specify any kind of gender discrimination or any kind of gender, masculine or feminine or third gender. No, it is in the post-gender world, where we are above the stereotypical boundaries of stereotypical boundaries of gender. So it talks about the fact, and cyborg is a creature with no origin story. Cyborg has no origin. You cannot identify any evolution, as Darwin have pointed out, the evolution of mankind from apes or etc. Cyborg has no origin. But what does cyborg mean? Cyborg actually blurs the boundaries between human and technology. And it is a kind of augmented human. This term is also an alternative term for cyborg people. cyborg mainly refers to that when human beings and the organs, any particular organ of human being is replaced by machines. For example, a person who has heart problem, he or she needs a pacemaker. So, what do you call a person with normal heart and a person with a pacemaker? Pacemaker is a machine, and that pacemaker is put inside human body so that the problems which are there in his heart or any kind of cardiac disease is there, so it can be recovered. Okay, so this way it can broaden the definition of human, because human and technology, obviously the boundaries are blurred. When inside a human body we are putting any kind of machine, pacemaker is an example, you can take any kind of machine, then it is an example of cyborg. For example, someone's eye is damaged and he needs an eye transplant. So a stone eye is put on that particular place. Now that he or she cannot be called a man or a woman. He is a cyborg. Because he is not totally human, some part of his body is associated with technology and it is controlled by batteries or controlled by some external things. It is not properly running as a normal human. So Donna Haraway coined cyborg for these particular humans. So it has been extended to the description of robots and AIs also. And then comes the term abhuman. Abhuman is the term which we have just discussed about Draculas and vampires and all these things. The regression of mankind. Abhuman. So abhuman means someone that is below the standard of human. And Kelly Hurley has elaborated the idea of abhuman, and Hurley mentions that abhuman is not quite human subject characterized by morphic variability, continually in danger of becoming not itself, becoming other. Think about the character of Count Dracula. At daytime he is a man, at night he is getting transformed into a vampire. So there is continuously a kind of flexibility, or you can say that there is a potential threat of becoming not itself, which means abhuman doesn't have any fixed existence. It can change its form, it can change its way of behavior, and it can become the other. If you read the first few pages of Dracula, you will find that the way Jonathan Harker describes Dracula, and even he also identifies that in Dracula's room, in Count Dracula's room at night, he is very sure that he is not a man, rather he is a vampire. And he mentions that the bed on which Count Dracula is lying is not a bed, rather it is a coffin. And as there was a popular belief that Dracula's can only be killed by driving a stake through the heart, and the stake is already driven, Jonathan Harker is horrified to see that the man is dead already, and it is very clear from the setting of the bed that it is not a bed, it is a coffin, and he is not a man, he is a Dracula. But in the morning, Count Dracula is again alive and he is talking with Jonathan Harker. He is a very hospitable man, he discusses about business purposes. Harker is clearly in confusion that who is this person, Count Dracula? Who is he? Is he a human? Is he a non-human? Is he a half-human? What is he? So, Kelly Hurley mentions that it is the idea of abhuman, it is continually in danger of becoming not itself, becoming the other. And it is against the morphic variability of human subject. Normal human qualities, human tendencies, these are there. But at some point of time, it is switched between the human world and the primitive world, or you may say the human world and the world of the tables. That is abhuman. So all these ideas are associated with post-humanism. There are so many post-human movies, the Avenger movies, or as you are very popular. I hope you have all watched these kind of movies, the Marvel series. all the movies in today's world mainly focusing on this idea of post-humanism. And if we want to sum up in one single word, then it is a kind of redefinition of humanism. If we take it in only one single word, that what is post-humanism? You can answer that it is redefining what is human, redefining the definition of human civilization and the role of human in today's world. In today's 21st century, what should be the role of human? That is what post-humanism is all about, as far as I have understood. So this is about the topic, a brief introduction to the topic. I know that there are a lot of things which needs attention. I am still reading on about post-humanism, and I will also request you that if you have any other information regarding post-humanism, you can definitely post it in the comment section. We will have a healthy discussion on it. And because post-humanism is a very new theory which is still getting attention, and researches are going on, so many people are commenting on that, so many books are being written. So it needs much exploration, and if I get some more information, then I will definitely share those things with you. Till now I have learned these things, these particular terms, and I hope you have get a clear idea, you have got a clear idea of what is post-humanism, a basic introduction to the theory, because it's a very complex thing. As we have read the other theories, those have an established theories, established books, and discussed for so long time, so it has a base. But post-humanism is a very new thing, and each and every theorist, each and every literary masters, they are describing their own point of view of post-humanism. So it doesn't have any fixed description. It doesn't have any fixed definition that what do you mean by post-humanism. Actually, today's world, all the theories in today's world, they are part of post-humanism, as far as I have understood. So that is about for today's class. And before summing up the video, I have two questions for you. As I have been reading about post-humanism, these two things strike in my mind, and I am also still trying to find out the answer. But I am putting the question for you. If some of you have any idea regarding this, you can definitely tell me. So I am very curious about the movies in which post-humanism is there. So if we take the description of Kelly Hurley's Abhuman, or the way robots are considered to be post-human, my question is that how can we define Spider-Man or Batman there? Are they also post-human? Particularly the scene, if we take the second part of Spider-Man 2, then you can very well remember that there is a very popular scene when Spider-Man saves a train whose brake is already failed, and he saves the train from destruction and saves so many people of the train using his superhuman power. So can we call Spider-Man as a post-human entity? And if it is, then which kind of post-humanism? Is he an abhuman? Is he a transhuman? Or can we call him a cyborg or something like that? So I have this question about Spider-Man and Batman movies, which are very popular. Of course, Spider-Man is a fictional character, as vampires or Dracula are also considered to be fictional, because there is no proper scientific proof that vampires are there. Yeah, people believe it, there are superstitions obviously, but there is no scientific proof. So if vampires are considered to be post-human, then can we consider Spider-Man also post-human? And can we interpret the Spider-Man movies as post-human movies? This is one question. And another question is regarding the recent Bollywood movies. I don't know whether all of you have watched it or not. It is a copy of a Gujarati movie, Shaitan, by Ajay Devgan and played by R. Madhavan. Recently released Bollywood movie. So I have also a question regarding the character of Shaitan. Those of you who have watched the movie, if you have any solution, any answer to this question, then please tell me in the comment section. First question is about, can Spider-Man be considered as post-human? And second question is about the character of Shaitan. If you have seen the movie, you can very well relate it that the character played by R. Madhavan, he is not a man, he is not a devil, rather he is a man with some supreme power who can control the underworld. And Shaitan very meticulously, in a very planned way, he arrives in a very peaceful family of the man played by Ajay Devgan. It's a very small family of one daughter and one son and his wife. So Shaitan arrives in their family and Shaitan takes as a target Devgan's daughter, who is named as Janvi. And he is trying to make Janvi as a part of his black magic. That is why he is called Shaitan. But the way he controls the world and the way he asserts his own superiority, that I am here today and you need to be with me, otherwise I will destroy your family, I will destroy your daughter. And if you are with me, then I will free your daughter from all the magical spells. She is now... she is now under my control, and if you are not willing to carry out my order, then I can destroy everything. And I am the most powerful. In today's world, there is no God. I am the most powerful. I am the Paramatma. He mentions that. So how can we define those characters who are a part of black magic, who are controlling the whole world in terms of black magic? And he is supremely powerful because and also supremely intellectual. The way he controls everything, the way he makes his influence over the whole family members, and the way he captures Janvi, this is something remarkable. So how do we call that particular character if we take from the perspective, if we take it from the perspective of the movie, then can it also be considered as post-human? I don't know the answers. Just these two questions came to my mind when I was reading about all these things. So that is why I am putting the questions to you. If any of you have any suggestions, any answers regarding that, then please let me know. I'll be very happy to have a discussion with you. So that is about my observation of post-humanism. You may agree with it or you may disagree. As far as I have understood, this is post-humanism, and definitely I am researching on the topic. I will read more books on post-humanism, and if I get some extra information, then I will make another video on this. Okay, so that is for today's class. Thank you for watching. We will meet soon in another class. Have a nice day.